Revelation chapter 4, verse number 1. Appreciate all those coming out to the house of God tonight. Appreciate the outstanding devotion and praise of the service. Amen?
Amen.
Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Don't miss no part of the service. Amen. Amen. Revelation chapter 4, verse number 1.
After this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet, talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit.
Yes.
And behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat upon
the throne. John was in the spirit, and God began to reveal things to him that the church would need throughout the gospel day. Now, in Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, it says he sent and signified, which meant that he put it in symbolic language. Let's skip down now to verse number 7, and it began to detail some of the things that he saw. Come on.
And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf, and the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the four beasts.
So here he said he saw these beasts, which in a better interpretation it would say living creatures. He saw these living creatures who represented the redeemed of all ages. Now go over to Ezekiel chapter 1, verse number 10, and let us the same vision with the symbolic language, which would help us understand what John saw. Come on and read.
Likeness of their faces.
Come on.
They four had the face of a man.
So here he said they four had the face of a man.
And the face of a lion.
So Ezekiel broke it down from a perspective that it wasn't individually, but they four had these attributes about them. Now, in the book of Revelation, as we said in the first chapter, it talks about the symbolism. Now, in order to properly understand the symbolism of Revelation, you can look at other places in Scripture in which things were done. And that's what we're going to do tonight as we began a series on the face of the lion, the eagle, the man, and the calf. Mm. And these were attributes of the redeemed that we must have collectively as a body and individually in order to be victorious in the gospel day.
Amen.
Now, at certain points of the gospel day, some of these attributes were more profound, and some of the historians have attributed to a specific period of time that represented where this phase of the church, that the church really needed this attribute at this phase. Absolutely. But as a whole, as Ezekiel brought out, there was a more totality that's needed in the experience of an individual, each of these phases, and there will be periods in your life in which some of the phases will be needed at a more profound time.
Amen.
So there may be an aspect of time in
right.
which you may be going through something in which you're going to have the face of a man.
Yes.
You're going to have to deal with it. There's going to be times in which you're going to have the face of a calf. And we're going to break this down tonight. This last one of the four is absolutely critical because in the seventh seal, in this ecumenical eighth beast age, the devil has endeavored to water down Christianity.
Amen.
Wow. The devil has endeavored to water down anything. I appreciate the song you sung. And when you were singing that song about, and there he stood upon the cross where Jesus died, something came over my spirit in there, and I said, Lord, help us, after he went to the cross for this gospel, help us not to preach nothing less than the deserving what he did on that cross.
Right. Yeah.
Help us not to water. He went through too much for us, my God, for us to water down the gospel, my God. So Lord, help us to proclaim the fullness of it. Well, whenever you take off something that is essential, you'll get the outcome.
Yes, sir.
Let me say that again.
Yes.
Whenever you take off something that is essential in the Word of God,
yes.
you're going to get the outcome. Yes. And the opposite of that is, you won't get the blessing that was to
my
bring.
God.
Yes.
My God.
Everything that the Word of God proclaims, everything that God asks us to do, all of it is important for us.
Yes.
If we ever not do some of it, take some off, put some away, then there will be an element of blessing and glory and manifestation that you're compromising. Because you're compromising, you're going to compromise the outcome as well.
Oh.
We're going to listen to the Word of God tonight regarding the face of the calf. How important it is for us to have this individually as well as collectively. In order to understand this, we got to go back to the beginning. So let's go back to Leviticus chapter number 9,
all right,
verse number 1.
And it came to pass on the eighth day that Moses called Aaron and his sons and the elders of Israel. And he said unto Aaron, take ye a young calf for a sin offering, and a ram for a burnt offering, without blemish, and offer them before the Lord.
Now don't just offer up anything, but it must be without blemish. Amen.
Right.
Thank the Lord. The Bible says we present our bodies a living sacrifice. Yes. Our lives are sacrificial to God. We don't want to just live anyway.
No, we can't.
Amen. Come on and read.
Help us, Lord.
And unto the children of Israel,
come on,
thou shalt speak.
Yes.
Saying, take ye a kid of the goat for a sin offering.
Come on.
And a calf and a lamb.
Come on.
Both of the first year.
Come on.
Without blemish for a burnt offering.
My Lord.
Also a bullock and a ram for a peace offering.
Uh-huh.
To sacrifice.
To what?
To sacrifice.
Okay. So here, as he began to initiate the Mosaic covenant that they were to live by after they came out of Egypt as a people of God, to be separated from the world, living in such a way that God could manifest himself. When the patriarchs, when Joseph was sold out, went down, amen, and his brothers, and God blessed them, so on and so forth, the king, amen, he had favor with the king, despite people trying to do you wrong. If you right with God, God will give you favor, amen. Yeah. He went down to Egypt and he had favor, even though he was slow, and the Potiphar wife, all that stuff happened, but he had favor. Well, another king rose up that knew not Joseph. And that king began to be intimidated by the blessings and how numerically they had grown, the people of God had grown down in Egypt, and they said, listen, if you don't get rid of these people, they're going to cause you problems.
Yeah.
If you don't get rid of these people, they're going to cause you problems. So they began to afflict them.
Yeah.
Well, they cried, and God heard their prayers, raised up Moses. You know what I was thinking? It said when Moses was come of years, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter,
right,
choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season.
Amen.
Don't you realize that there's some young people sitting in our midst tonight, some young people, amen, in the congregation that will be able to be a blessing to their generation, but the devil is bidding high for their souls, wanting to be something great. Moses was sitting there, should I be the son of Pharaoh's daughter? I'm that guy. Or do I say, you know what? I ain't studying what the world is trying to offer me. It's a generation. There's a place I need to play on God's team.
God,
the people of
God
are suffering. They need me. They need my voice. They need my gifts. They need my support. I'm going to choose rather. I don't want to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. I don't want to be the hip-hop rap artist of Jackson County or Kalamazoo or Lansing or wherever. I don't want to be the one that's throwing the parties and that guy. I don't want to be the gridiron great, have people worshiping me because I'm doing 360s on people. I want to be doing 360s on the devil's head, amen. I want to give my gifts. I want to give my power to the kingdom of God. I'm not going to let the saints suffer, helping out this generation. And here I am being used by the devil. I'd rather be a doorkeeper for God, amen, than a star out there in the world, my God. So here, when Moses was come of years, he said, I'm not studying what you're trying to offer me, man. The people of God need me. God used him to raise him up and led the people of God out.
Amen.
But he said, I need you to have order. I need you to have something to live by. And he gave them the law. Well, in the law, he denoted the calf as a type of sacrifice.
Yes.
And it denoted consecration.
Yes.
The more you sacrifice, it was a direct correlation to the consecration or your commitment to the cause of God.
Amen.
So here he said he must have the face of a lamb, denoting the sacrifice that was essential in order for the people of God to be victorious throughout the gospel day. In order for us to be victorious and to do what God would have for us to do, there will be a direct correlation to the sacrifice, to the consecration. Now, we're going to show you how the devil has tried to remove it from this generation, and then we're going to show you examples of those in the Bible who actually sacrificed and the outcome of it. Let's go to the first element. Go over to Acts chapter 8. Verse 40, even in the New Testament, they understood the face of the calf. Acts 8, 40, even in the New Testament, they understood the face of the calf. I'm going to read.
But Philip was found at Azotha, and passing through, he preached in all the cities. But Philip was found at Azotha, and passing through, he preached in all the cities. Then he came to Caesarea. Saying unto Aaron.
Go back one verse.
To whom our fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again unto into Egypt.
Go over to Acts chapter 7, verse 40, verse 39. Start at verse 39. Come on and read.
To whom our fathers would not obey.
To whom our fathers would not obey.
But thrust.
Now he's not talking just about his father that actually birthed them. He's talking about the fathers of Israel.
Yeah.
Sometimes they would say, whom our fathers and any other. They're not saying like so-and-so down the street was my father, but they're talking about the fathers of Israel and the historical accounts of Israel and the fathers of the time. Come on and read.
But thrust him from them.
Come on.
And in their hearts turn back again into Egypt.
Come on and read.
Saying unto Aaron, make us gods to go before us.
Come on.
For as for this Moses, which brought us out of the land of Egypt, we would not, what is become of him?
So just like the pastor was preaching yesterday, because God didn't come through when a person wants, they want to make another god.
Uh-oh.
They want to go another way. And I've seen individuals do stuff like this, and it's very serious. And many times, individuals will think that I can just do what I want. I'm going to tell you, you go make another guy, you go another way, it's not as easy as to wipe your mouth.
Right.
I've seen individuals say that, you know what, I'm just going to just do this and ask God to forgive me. Be careful. Be careful that you just don't just go run and do something. See, the individual say, well, I'm just going to go and do this real quick, and then I'm going to come back and get saved, and then you don't want to wait on God. Be careful. Be careful. You'll spend a great amount of time trying to recover that first joy, that first love, that first, come on, read. Come on,
and they made a calf in those days, and offered sacrifice unto the idol,
come on,
and rejoiced in the works of their own hands.
My Lord.
Then God turned and gave them up to worship the Holy
God. So then they made a calf in those days and offered sacrifice unto the idol. So even in the New Testament, when they were talking about Israel, they understood that the calf was a direct correlation to the, they understood that the calf, there was a direct correlation to sacrifice.
Yes.
Amen? So you can get the chart for us and show it. We want to show you some things on the chart. Okay? So here, we see that there's a direct correlation to the sacrifice. Now, let us look at John the Baptist. John chapter 1, verse 29. And let's see, he understood also the sacrifice. John chapter 1, verse 29.
The next day. John sees Jesus coming.
Come on.
And saith, yes. Behold,
yes,
the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world.
John understood Jesus as the sacrifice. The first time John, in the book of John, said, hold on. He saw Jesus as different. Now, this was not just a normal occurrence. This was actually something different. Who was John the Baptist and Jesus in regards to natural relationship? Thank you. When did they first meet? In the womb.
In the womb.
So this was different. When he saw Jesus coming, this was a revelation.
Yes.
Lord. He had been with him all the time. He had been with him in the womb. No doubt playing together, hitting each other upside the head, running down the street, throwing whatever they did back in the day, playing games, whatever games they were playing. But here, it was something different.
My God.
Here, he understood his mission and who he was, him being the Messiah, knowing that somebody had to come and sacrifice for the sins of all the world.
Yes.
And he understood because God gave him a revelation. Yes. Let me just say this. There are some things in your life and my life that you will never ever have unless God give you a revelation.
Amen.
There is an understanding that you will never have. You will be by, you will be by it from the womb.
My God.
You'll be by it from the womb.
Oh,
you'll be running around it every day. But unless God give you a revelation of the church of God, you won't receive what it is. You can be here from a little old baby. You can be here saying, doing this, that, sitting up. You can get even up here singing songs, my God. But unless you get before God and he give you a revelation from heaven, letting you know this is my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I'm not talking about in no generic term. This is my church. No, he will let you know this is my church and what it stands for, what it means to be church of God. You will understand, and it must come directly from heaven.
Amen.
You ain't getting that from flesh and blood. You will sit right here among it and not understand it, and you'll find yourself cutting off stuff and being involved in stuff that's not church of God because you haven't had a revelation, and you'll think it came from man. But let me tell you, God didn't give a doctrine or a standard. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
So unless you get before God on a real thing, no play game thing, you must die for this gospel.
That's right.
Throughout the gospel day, every force in the world has come against the church of God.
Yes.
Catholicism, Protestantism, all back in paganism, they're all coming against the people of God. This thing is real. People have stood. My God, a head's been chopped off.
Yes.
Mine is coming to eat
Yes.
Off. Not flinching an inch.
No.
Won't do nothing. Why? It wasn't because they were that strong. It wasn't because they were that excited about the church they went to. But God put something down in their soul.
My God.
My God.
God gave them something down in their soul.
Amen.
And they wouldn't back up an inch on it.
Amen.
But let me tell you the same way. Just like they wouldn't back up an inch, God got some people way over here.
Yeah.
Amen. That won't back up an inch on what God
said. Hallelujah.
Go where you want to go, do what you want to do, but as for me and my house, we going to serve the Lord. We going to stand for everything that God has shown me. And I have to get before God to get this down in my soul. Let me say this, there's an earthquake, and we're in the midst of it.
Yes.
God is shaking. Listen,
yes.
Anything that God has not put down in your soul will not stand.
Amen.
Anything that God himself did not give you will not stand. As we come through this great time of fire, it will not stand. If God didn't give it to you, it ain't gonna stay. You will find yourself, my God, the days of going along with something, going along with the crowd, half in, half out, that ain't gonna cut it today. You gotta get before God, turn your plate up, get something from heaven down in your soul. It's real. You better die than back up on it.
Amen.
Amen.
That's the only way you gonna make it.
Amen.
That's the only way you're gonna be church of God in this world.
Hold the way.
Shake everything that can
My
shake.
God, help us.
Everything is not 100% in your closet by yourself. And ain't nobody around. Church of God. And your home. Church of God. Family come, family go. Church of God. This is personal down in my soul.
Amen.
Amen.
My God.
You're gonna have to have it like that.
Yes.
You're gonna have to have it like that.
Yes.
So here, John got a revelation. And when he got a revelation, they said, hold on. Behold. I've been with this man every day of my life. This is cutting, this ain't cutting Jesus no more. This ain't, no. Behold, the Lamb of God. The sacrifice. So here we see that even John correlated the calf with sacrifice. Let us look at the first work of grace and how the enemy today wants to remove the Lamb out of the first work of grace. Some people on the radio today, online, that would view this or hear this, they probably have never fully understand the process of getting into the kingdom or the process of truly getting saved or being born again. You cannot get saved without the Lamb.
Right.
out the calf. All right? Let's go over to Matthew chapter 3, verse 7. And let's give it an example of the antithesis or the opposite of what was supposed to be done. Way back here, the Holy Ghost ministry had discernment and would not allow the church to be corrupted with individuals coming that were trying to come in without the Lamb. And today's generation, this message needs to go all over the world, because there is a boatload of people that are not getting, my God, they're trying to come to Jesus without the sacrifice. They're trying to come and be saved without the sacrifice. There's a bunch of preachers that's trying to grow mega churches by removing the Lamb out.
Yes.
They're trying to take the Lamb out of justification.
Yes.
They're trying to take the Lamb out of being born again.
Yeah.
And they'll say, I joined so-and-so church. Yeah. Listen, you can't join anything, my God. You need to join Jesus.
Amen.
You got to have the Lamb. So here John the Baptist was baptizing. Individuals were being saved. But some people came up and they wanted to take part in it. And listen to what he said on how essential the Lamb is. Come on, read.
But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who have warned you to flee from the wrath to come?
Come on.
Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance.
Hold on. What are y'all doing coming up here? To be baptized. You want to be baptized? I'm not interested in gaining a big church. John the Baptist wasn't about that.
Nope.
I'm not interested in gaining a big church so I can get a big offering and drive some fancy car and live in some fancy. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in making sure that you meet the biblical qualifications.
Amen.
Because if we don't, we want to have a church full of mess.
Yes.
We want to have a church full of foolishness.
Yes.
And unfortunately, that's what's going on today in this generation.
Yeah.
You got individuals, my God, that is coming up to join somebody's church, and they're involved with people they're not even married to. The Bible speaks about fornication. Flee fornication. Yeah. That shouldn't be once in adultery. It shouldn't be the same. But now you got the church filled with it because they're bringing people in their congregation without the Lamb. John said, bring forth fruit meant for repentance. The Bible said, godly sorrow working repentance, not to be repented of. You got to be godly sorrow for every sin you've ever committed.
Yes.
You got to have brokenness and contrition and willing to repent. You got to be willing to give up all. You got to sacrifice all that you're involved in that's not to the glory of God. Everything that you got understanding on when you come to an altar of prayer at an old church of God camp meeting or church of God altar, my God. Everything that you're involved in that's not to the glory of God. You got to be, first of all, sorry that you've ever done it. You got to be sorry that you hurt God. You got to be sorry for all the sins you've ever committed. And you got to ask God to forgive you and to show the sincerity. You got to be willing to repent. You got to be willing to turn from it, walk from it, and never do it again.
My God.
You cannot take the Lamb out of justification. If you do, the church will end up corrupted.
Yes.
Go over to Isaiah chapter 55, verse 7. Verse 6, the Lamb in justification, willing to give up all I know to be wrong. That's the only way you're going to get a real witness from God.
My God.
That's the only way you're going to get real power down in your soul. Some people say, I went to church, joined it, went back that night, I was doing the same thing I used to do. Did you give up all? Did you let it all go? Did you get rid of all? I'm done. From this day, I'm not going to wean myself off. I'm done today, Lord Jesus. All that I'm involved in is not glory to God. That's not a proper, that's sinful, Lord. I'm asking you to take it out of my heart. I'm done with it, Lord. I don't know where I may live. I don't know what I'm going to listen to. But everything that's not to the glory of God, I'm finished with it. My body is a temple of God. I've been doing all type of ungodly stuff with my body. Lord, you cannot dwell in an unholy temple. Lord, today I'm done. Take these habits. I've been smoking cigarettes for 52 years, for 30 years, for 19 years, Lord. Lord, I've been popping pills, Lord. I'm addicted by it. Lord, I've been smoking weed, Lord. I'm sorry, God. I've been putting, my God, all type of toxins down in my body, Lord. But, Lord, I want to be saved. I'm asking you to forgive me, Lord. Lord, my God, and when you hear that, you're hearing the Lamb come to the altar call. You see the Lamb come as an altar worker. You want to hear the Lamb. It must be a willing sacrifice. You can't take it from them. You can't tell them. They got to be willing. And the tears start flowing. They're letting you know, I don't want to do it no more, preacher. I don't want to do it no more. But how can I stop? And we say, are you willing to give it up? Are you willing to be done with it? That's all you got to worry about. Yes, I am. But how am I stop? I've been doing it for 20 years.
Amen.
You won't want it no more.
Amen.
The power of it will be broken.
Amen.
And now when you walk from it, he'll send grace and mercy behind you. Amen. Because where sin abounds, there's grace much more power. You're kept by the power of God. But all he needs to see is the Lamb. Come on and read.
Seek ye the Lord.
Seek ye the Lord.
While he may be found.
Yeah, when God is dealing with you, you gotta seek God then. Don't say, I'm gonna go home again. I'll be back later. No, you gotta seek ye the Lord while he may be found. While the inspiration is there.
Right.
While God is dealing with you.
Right.
While you're right there, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Don't say next week, next month, let me get out of high school. Let me get out of middle school. Let me go back home and clean myself up. How you gonna clean yourself up? You're the reason you're in the condition you are right now. Come as you are. You ain't got to clean nothing up. I'm thankful that I serve a God that will let us come as we are. You can be messed up, down and out, broke, all these things. You can come as you are. But thank God we serve a God that don't leave you as you are. Praise God. He will clean you up.
Amen.
Turn you around. Set your feet on solid ground. Thank God we serve a real God. You just bring the Lamb. You just bring the Lamb. He'll do his part. Come on and read.
Seek ye the Lord.
Seek ye the Lord.
While he may be found.
Call ye upon him.
While he is near.
While conviction is there. Call ye upon him while he is near. Some people say, I'm not going to get saved until I'm about to die. You better hope the Lord is near then.
My God.
You better hope he's near. You better hope conviction. You can't come. Jesus said, you can't come unless the Father draws you.
Right.
You can't come unless the Father hold on.
That's right.
So if you don't have conviction, you can't get saved because the plane is going down. You just afraid. You got to bring forth fruit. The fruit you brought forth is fear. The fruit you need to bring forth is godly sorrow.
Right.
Godly sorrow cannot be concocted by yourself. You can have earthly sorrow, but not godly sorrow.
Right now.
Godly sorrow is God enlightening you of your condition, of what you've done. God dealing with your heart. God through conviction making you sorry that you've been involved in it.
Yes.
Godly sorrow. So here he said, come on and read it.
Let the wicked forsake his way.
Let the wicked forsake his way. Spell that word, please.
Way, W-A-Y.
Let the wicked forsake his way. See, some people want to come and they don't understand Bible salvation. And the world today will teach them, okay, the big things you stop doing, but these things over here. Or you can cherry pick what you want to do. Okay, I'm not going to gamble no more, but I'm going to still sell a little weed on the side to get my rent. Well, listen, when you get saved, the Bible says, the just shall live by faith.
Amen.
Amen. If you got to trust God to pay your rent, trust God to pay your rent. David said, I've been young. Now I'm old,
amen.
But I ain't never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging for God. Ain't gonna leave you. You take a stand for the gospel tonight, and you say, Lord, I'm willing to take a stand for the gospel tonight. I promise you, God ain't gonna forsake you. I don't know how he may take care of you, but he ain't gonna leave you out there. So here he said, let the wicked forsake his way. What is he saying there? Bring the calf.
All right.
Forsake his way. That's his way of seeing. The whole way he's on. Everything about it. I'm done. Not, okay, this over here part, this over here. No. The whole way. That's why I appreciate somebody I heard. They said that they got saved. They didn't go and clean up their phone numbers and their other social media. But they got rid of it. They just said, you know what? 99% of this stuff, my whole hashtag, my whole personification was foolishness. Everybody I was connected with was absolutely foolish. It was either sinful or feeding the flesh.
Amen.
So you know what? I'm getting a whole clean start. I'm done.
Yeah.
See, when you see stuff like that, you're seeing the Lamb. Uh-oh. You're hearing testimonies. Oh, the Lamb. The Lamb. You're hearing it. Uh-oh. So, and, oh, I don't want to get ahead of myself. Oh, the glory to come back to the Lamb.
Help him. Help him.
Help God. But you're hearing the Lamb. Well, you can also see other stuff. People come around. And you notice, some mean, see, the saints got a certain witness that God gives them.
Yes.
Just like God gives you a witness when you pay the full price, God gives the saint a witness.
Yes.
You can say what you want, do what you want, come among the saints. It'll just be a something that just, it just, it's just a witness. They ain't get just, it, they're not judging you. They're not trying to say you ain't a, it's just something. And in love, they don't even try to accept. In love, they'll try to, oh, praise the Lord, goodness said. But it'll be a witness that only comes from the Lamb.
Mm-hmm.
When the Lamb is there.
Thank God for the Church of God message. Amen.
My God, the saints get excited. Some are down in their soul. Why? Because they bought the Lamb. And the Lamb that they bought registers and witnesses with the Lamb you brought. They knew what they had to do. And God ain't no respected person. I had to bring the Lamb. So I rejoice when I hear you brought it too.
Amen.
Amen. deceiving when you see individuals come and you say, ooh, the Lamb. Ooh, the Lamb. Oh, thank you, Mother. Amen. The Holy Ghost. Oh, they bought it. You can hear them talk about saints and this, that, and other. My friends cut me off, and I told them that I wasn't going to the party. I told them, oh, the Lamb. Oh, the Lamb. Listen, when your friends forsake you, God gives you some new friends. Amen. Amen. And mother and father, my mother and father, they told me, if I didn't go to the prom with this worldly dress on, with my chest out, and all my stuff up, and dancing boogie, 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 boogie all night long, that I couldn't stay here no more. Oh, the Lamb. The Lamb, not that we're excited that you're about to get kicked out, but it's just the Lamb. Praise the Lord. I tell my boss, he told me to tell him that he's not here, but I knew he was right there. So I said, boss, I can't keep telling folk that you're not here. I can't keep fixing the book saying that you did this and you did that when you didn't really do this and you really didn't do that. Oh, same thing. They took my job from me. The Lamb. Uh-oh, they had to give me a reassignment. They put me way in the back in the mail room, down on the floor, way over here. Why? Because I wouldn't lie. I told them I'd rather die than lie. Oh, the Lamb. The Lamb. So here, he said, the process, Isaiah, of justification. Let the wicked forsake his way. I'm done. I'm done. You cannot get through without the Lamb in justification.
Right.
And just to let you know, he said, we're not going to go there, but he said over in Luke, the 14th chapter, around the 28th verse, he said, listen, I don't want to confuse you. I don't want to make you think you can get something cheap. He said, sit down and count the cost.
Mm-hmm.
Just sit down and count the cost. If you want this, it'll be the best experience you ever had in your life. Every habit you ever had, it will be a thing in the past. Give me scripture on that, Brother Lee. How can you say that? Every habit I ever had. What if I was a cursor? What if I was a drink? What if I used to lie? What if I hated people? What if I was prejudiced? What if I had all these spirits down in me? What if I was a homosexual? How can you say every spirit will be a thing of your past? Well, the Bible said you have the quickened who
right
were
now.
Dead. My Lord, in trespasses and sins, in time past, walked according to the course of this world, in time past, according to the children of disobedience, but God.
Amen.
Who was rich in mercy.
Amen.
The Bible said, therefore, if any man be in Christ,
amen.
Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. It didn't say some things. It said, you just bring the Lamb. You just get on your knees and be sincere. And saints, the first phase of the Lamb in the experience of justification, personally, we don't ever want to forsake that. And collectively, we must keep the Lamb a part of justification.
Amen.
After justification, there's an experience that God has for the church. Let us go over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse number 3. The second phase of the Lamb.
For this is the will of God. Even your sanctification.
Well, God's will is for us to go on to sanctification. Sanctification in the Old Testament in typology is all throughout. And in the tabernacle, there was two rooms.
Yes, right.
The first was the holies, and the second was the Holy of Holies. Well, in the first, before the first room, there was the brazen altar. And on the brazen altar had to be a sacrifice.
Right.
In order to get into the first room, you had to go past the laver. But the brazen altar, you had to have a sacrifice. Well, actually, if you study it out, going into the second room, the golden altar, there was blood brought in that was actually applied, denoting there's a sacrifice to get into the first altar, the room, and there's a sacrifice to get into the second room. The second room represented the Holy of Holies.
My God was holy.
This was the holies, but this was the Holy of Holies where you went into the very presence of God. Well, that's in typology. So here you have a person that comes to God because mankind's fall was twofold. They fell because of actual sin, and then they also inherited a fallen nature. So there was two steps down that we went into. Well, God delivered a plan that would bring us back up to the level we fell from. So we first come to God asking forgiveness for all the the sins we've ever done. And that lamb must be there, and we must meet it from the depths of our heart. That's why the Bible said his spirit will bear witness with our spirit. Yes. Amen. God knows. I don't know. You can cry till you turn blue, or you cannot drop a tear. But God knows when you really paid the price, when you really have let go of all you know to be wrong. And may God, that's the first. Well, then the second, what God really wants us to get back to, is a fully sanctified experience. That's when a person has been cleaned and justified. Now they're going and to present their lives, all their future, all their will, everything to God. God burns up that carnal or that selfish nature, that selfish that was inherited, and now they're totally surrendered over to God for him to do what he wants with their lives. Okay, that second position, that second experience requires a sacrifice. Go over to Galatians chapter 2:20.
Amen.
Galatians chapter 2:20. Come on. The face of the Lamb. We've got to have it in the church. Now, let's really speak pointedly tonight, saints. So pray for me. Come on and read.
I am crucified.
Paul said, I am crucified. The Lamb. Okay. Y'all catch it? Yeah. It's a theme going here. Mm-hmm. I am crucified with Christ. Come on.
Nevertheless. I live.
Okay. I live. He's talking now about naturally. I'm still here.
Yet,
come on.
Yet. Not I.
Not I.
But Christ liveth in me.
But I'm totally filled with his spirit. He lived. Listen to this real quickly. When Jesus was leaving, if they really understood what was taking place, they probably wouldn't have crucified him. He said, y'all got me, I'm here. And I'm with this group here. But the plan goes, when I get crucified, I'm with them, but I shall be in them. I'm actually going to go away. The Holy Ghost dispensation is going to come. And the Holy Ghost is going to come. The same spirit that quickened Jesus, that Holy Ghost is going to be in all of these bodies that accept him and be filled with his spirit. That's why in Antioch, when they saw these people, they said, I thought we crucified them. There go Christ. They just like Christ. Christians. Christ. And they were first called. Whoa. We thought we got rid of him. He's all over the place.
That's right.
So here Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. I came and I surrendered on Damascus Road.
All right, now.
Eyes were blinded for 3 days. And I just prayed for me. Gave up all, consecrated all, filled with the Holy Ghost. Went down to the Arabia for 3 years. God anointed me for my ministry. And I've been going forth ever since. So he said, Galatians, so you can understand it. I am crucified to show you what took place in my heart when I truly sacrificed all. Go over to Romans chapter 12, verse number 1. Let's break it down. When he spoke to the Romans, he also explained the importance of the Lamb. Come on and read.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
He's beseeching or begging the brethren in Rome, the saints in Rome.
By the mercies of God.
By the mercies of God.
That ye present your bodies a living sacrifice.
Here he's teaching them. If you really want to find doctrine, go through the book of Rome. Men's. So here he's teaching them to go on to that experience. And he said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, present your bodies a living. Bring the lamb. Bring the lamb. The enemy wants to take the lamb out of sanctification. Have an individual come and get saved, but they never go on to truly sell all the way out. A church without sanctified people will be a church lacking in power.
That's right.
There's a power that comes from a sold out experience. When God is your all in all. When the Bible says, set your affections. The Bible speaks about the same thing. It said, crucify the affections and the lust thereof. Listen, there is nothing in the world that I'm lusting after.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, let me take it a step further. Lord, help me tonight. There is nothing in the world that I'm affectionate about. I'm not saying that I don't enjoy, I love like this, that, and the other, but there's something different. God, it said, set your affection.
Yes.
That's why there's certain things that we don't promote on certain levels.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Because there's an affection that's so affiliated with it, you have to commit yourself and give yourself all day long and studying and practice and this and that. All day long. And see, we serve a jealous God.
Yes.
That God don't want your affection. Listen, it's a wonderful thing for you to go to school, but don't set your affection. I'm going to be this, I'm getting this degree and this degree. It's a wonderful thing to get a job, but don't go around talking about, oh yeah, I'm getting this promotion, I'm going here, and I'm going to be over Northwest Territory, and I'm going to go, listen, I want to do a good job. The Bible said for me to do unto my boss as I would do unto God, so I want to be there on time. I want to do a good job, but I'm letting you know, somebody may get promoted over me if it's based upon, my God, how a fire, the giving they are to this, that, and the other. But let me tell you, saints, don't you worry about that. You set your affection. Do Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of God. God will give you favor. He'll open doors no man can shut.
That's right.
People wonder, how in the world do you get all this faith? Why? Because I take care of God's business.
Amen.
He takes care of my business.
That's right.
So here, he said, present your bodies a living sacrifice. And that's to know him. We want the saints to know when a person comes and gets saved, we should be encouraging them. It was a blessed thing the other day to go into Sunday school and hear them talking about, and the messages going forth about yesterday, about just God is our sword. That's just living sacrifice.
Yeah.
I'm presenting my body. God is. I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm sanctified. I'm set apart to God's promises, his word, his will. And that's where power comes in at. But the devil would love for folk just to be around here. And they never went forth and totally sacrificed their lives. One song said, I saw the death.
I had to die.
I had to die. Lord, my will. It's people that are still trying to be around, trying to do things, but they still got their will. And it's not noticeable unless something comes that's contrary to what they really want to do. And if it's something that they really want to do, then they will just try to go along and keep going without dealing with that. They will just try to keep going, but when a person is fully sanctified, they will say, hold on.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I got to do what I got to do. I'm going to have to pray. I'm going to have to cry. But Lord, you put your finger here. Lord, you want me to go here.
Mm.
Lord, you want me to do this. I'm sold out to you, God. If I got to take half the money, mm-hmm. I'll take half the money.
Mm.
But I will not commit myself to something.
Help us.
Take me this, that, and the other, totally destroy my consecration. So whatever, Lord, I want to be sold out for you.
My God.
You. Lord, if this relationship is not the perfect will of God, I'm not asking for something that I can think by. Will it go with? Lord, is this the perfect? See, sanctified people want the perfect will of God.
Yes.
That's true.
Carnal people will seek after the permissive will of God.
That's good,
brother. You got a Bible against it. Amen. You can do it. Well, the Bible says, you know what? You're seeking somebody only in the Lord. So really the ministry don't got a whole bunch to say to you unless there's a clear manifest witness that they're unregenerated. We've seen sin. Beside that, the ball is in your court.
Mm-hmm.
You can, somebody got saved yesterday. We say, take your time. Let's see their fruit. The Bible said, lay hands on you, no man. So definitely that principle applies to marriage. Take your time. I'm sorry, but I just, if you ever want to see the pastor back up, let him hint at something that's a principle in God's word.
Yeah.
And you express what you want to do with some affection behind it.
Yep.
Very well.
Thank God.
Very well. I'm not going to fight with you. Do what you're going to do. But a sanctified person is, and hold on, Lord, is this going to make me better? Is this going to improve me? Every major decision that you make in life should make you majorly better.
Yeah.
My God.
Where you go to school, folks should be getting witnessed to. I just can't just, I'm going here. No. Where I work, it provided me opportunities. My God. No. I want to be in the perfect will of God that the Holy Ghost can back up what I'm doing and manifest himself through me as a witness there. I spend too much time here for just to be doing something. All right. Now, here is the third point. Let us go to John. 1 John 1:8. The third calf. We have the calf in justification is essential. The calf is essential in sanctification. We don't want to remove the sacrifice out of the experience of full salvation. The calf is needed. Justification, for sanctification, and for the third point as well. 1 John 1:8. Come on.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves.
So John was dealing with those that had not accepted Christ, and he's telling them, listen, if you ain't accepted Christ and you say you have no sin, you're deceiving yourself. Why? Because paganism offered no deliverance from sin. And the Mosaic covenant did not offer deliverance from sin. There was an atonement there, but there was no deliverance. That's why it said, there is none righteous, no, not one. That's why it said, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Why? Because A, we're born in sin, and the Mosaic covenant offered no deliverance from it. So John said, if we say we have no sin, and you haven't accepted Christ, you deceive yourself.
Right.
All right, come on and read.
We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
Come on.
If we confess our sin,
if you confess it,
he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins.
Come on.
And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Did you read verse number 7?
But if we walk in the light.
Here we go. But if we walk in the light.
As he is in the light.
As he is in the light.
We have fellowship one with another.
Okay, now go to Matthew chapter 5, verse 30. If we walk in the light. This is the third aspect of the calf that we need. The calf is needed in justification. It will be clear with God. The calf is needed in sanctification. The calf is needed. Come on, read.
And if thy right hand offend thee.
Okay, let's line it up. So the Bible said we walk in the light as he's in the light, and we have fellowship one with the other. Light is called understanding. Alright? It's not talking about natural light, it's talking about understanding. When a person gets saved, even maybe even sanctified, there may be some things you don't understand. There may be something that you may not, that God hadn't dealt with you on that yet. That's why we don't go around forcing people. Saying you need to do this, you need to do that. No. Because God, unless God reveals it to them, they're doing it because you said it.
Right.
All right? So you just let them be good and saved. And keep coming to services. Come to morning service, amen. Yes. Amen. Morning service, help me out a lot, amen.
Amen.
Yes. Morning service, my God. So here, he says, if we walk in the light, that's understanding. See, God says, I won't put more on you than you're able to bear.
My God.
But we're with the weight, make it escape, so on and so forth. But I'm taking you.
Yes.
I'm taking you. You got to have the calf, because as you're walking in light, there will be some things that God will give you light on that you must be willing to sacrifice in order to maintain the fellowship.
My God.
In order to maintain the unity with God. There may be something you may not fully perceive, but as you're walking, you got to have the calf, a continual part of your experience.
Amen.
It may be something as simple as you and your job, you at school, and if somebody's getting a little bit too close to you. And the Holy Ghost began to quicken you. Be careful with that.
Yes.
Be careful with that. Be careful with that. He's giving you an understanding. Hold on. Hold on. Say, there must be a willingness. I'm done with it. I'm done with it. I'm done with it, Lord. It may be something that you wear. And you know what? And I'm going to go real deep with this one.
Yes, please.
You may just be too into it.
Come on, brother. All right.
It just may mean, and I appreciate the power I saw come over this brother's life. I'm not going to say his name. But this brother got saved. And when he got saved, he was walking in light. God was blessing him. God was blessing him. Well, and don't take this the wrong way. Let God deal with you how he needs to deal with you. This brother had so many pairs of Jordans. It was, Jordans is his very expensive tennis shoes. If you want to wear them, that's on you. I ain't getting on that. But he had so many pair of them, lined up a certain way, coordinated a certain way, named a certain way. Nobody said no, we ain't bother him. We're not, no, they ain't look at him. For, they, I really noticed it. But he said, God been dealing with me. But all these Jordans, all the, I'm waiting, for waiting in line. You know, the 23's coming out tonight at midnight. And late to service. Listen, remember that street meeting the other night? Where's you at? But you lined up the night before at midnight. Man, don't take my spot, man. Hey, bro, get your hands up off of me. But no grace in me, you shouldn't have been there. But my point is this. There was something, a place that God was endeavoring to take him in God.
My God.
And the Bible said, love not. It wasn't talking about you can't be in the world because we're here. But it says love not.
Yes.
There was something there that was an attachment and affinity that God was asking him, giving him life, that our relationship must go deeper. And there's understanding that there's a that even the world perceives what means a lot to you. I don't want nothing to be magnified in you but me. If they even perceive, here you are, yeah, you're saved, but you still got that same spirit. What? You got to be Dapper Dan, and you got to be a Dapper Susie. You just got this and this and this and this and this and this. That. Listen, the Bible don't want you to lift up that stuff you wear. Yes, look nice. Yes, have on clean, nice shoes. But the Bible said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. That's a witness to the world when you're able to say, and they knew how you was caught up in your hairstyle this way and that way. They knew you were spending $140 every week getting this done and that done and highlighted. Highlights. Anyway, they knew all this stuff you were doing, this, that, and the other. My God. But they came and they saw, my God, a change take place. And you may say, well, it's about the inside. Listen, you get your inside changed, it'll affect the outside.
Right.
I'm not even talking about standards or doctrine. I'm talking about consecration.
Right.
Once your consecration is upset, you won't be so concerned about, my God, making sure that this is that and that and that. The things you used to be so affectionate about, you will just wear this world as a loose garment. And the world sees that.
Right.
Whoa. And there's a power that comes when you draw closer to God and further. Most people I've ever seen went over to old Sister Green's house. Night she passed away. He went in there. Man, the sister had a chair here, some books, some tapes that she would send out. A bed I don't think had been slept in that day. This, that, and the other. Just the kingdom. The kingdom. The kingdom. The kingdom. So in order, as we advance our experience, the calf must be manifested, because there will be things. Listen, there may be some things about your character.
Yes.
You may just be a snappy person because you grew up in a household in which there were some snappy people in there before.
Right.
And in order for you to be heard, you had to be snappy. So you caught that same spirit that they had in order to be around it, in order to be accepted. So you're just a snappy person. So here, anybody that ever deals with you, got to deal with your snappiness. It's always just snappy. Somebody do this that you don't like, you're going to say, they ain't going to do that to me. Listen, the Bible said you got to become a worm if you have to be. Be walked. Don't let God defend you. Say, Lord, be a defense all around.
Yes.
I'm going to defend myself.
Yeah.
Let God defend you.
Amen.
Amen. God is more than able. He defended my God, the children of Israel, and he can defend you as well.
Yeah.
So God may show some things. You may just run your mouth too much. You can't keep nothing in. As soon as you find out something, you're going to just talk, talk, talk.
Yeah.
Say this, say this, say this. Listen, be quiet. Study to be quiet, my God. Don't just say everything you got to say. Don't just pick up the phone calling for prayer. You know all the saints' business. You know everybody. How's somebody going to come to you for prayer and they feel like you're going to tell everybody what they're coming to you about? Why are you praying enough and you're talking all the time? God can deal with you. He'll let you know. I talk too much.
Amen.
And I'm asking you to refine me.
Amen.
So Lord, I'm willing, my God, to have that as a calf. I'm willing to sacrifice that, Lord. I'm willing to sacrifice that. So we must have a calf, a part of our experience, as we continue our journey. Last point, go real quickly. Over to the body of Christ. We must have a calf collectively in order for us to be the people of God and have the glory of God. Exodus chapter 40, verse number 30. So the calf is needed as we continue our journey and God brings us closer to him. We must have that sacrifice. Have that sacrifice. You may have a calling in your life. God may tell you, now listen, listen, every Friday you can't go out with them no more. Hold on, what you saying, God? Ain't nothing sinful going about to get something to eat. I didn't say that. But what I got for you, you ain't no way to go out every Friday no more. No, what I got for you is different than that. The Bible says, through a desire, a man having separated himself, seeketh and intermeddles with all wisdom. Mother was telling me in a certain congregation, she had a young one of her children really seeking God. She said, Brother Lee, I see him on a fast day. I'm not eating today, Mom. I see him in there having devotion. I see him. That witness wouldn't have came if it wasn't no calf. Here God is dealing with this child in a more refined way. We got to have that calf. Real quickly, go ahead and read this in church. Come on.
And he set the laver between the tents of the of the congregation.
Come on.
And the altar.
Uh-huh.
And put water there to wash withal.
All right.
And Moses and Aaron and his sons washed their hands and their feet thereat.
My Lord, clean. Come on.
When they went into the tent of the congregation,
uh-huh.
and when they came near unto the altar, they washed as the Lord commanded Moses.
My. I'm about to get to the part where there's glory, but I just must mention this as we're on our way there. You will never find real glory where you don't see clean living.
That's right, brother. Right.
Don't ever be confused. You will never find real glory if you don't see honesty.
Yeah.
Integrity.
Amen.
Anybody that you see with real glory ain't no shady people. Mm-hmm. They're honest. They have integrity about them. All their dealings, they just, hold on. They're willing to even suffer if they have to. So here we saw clean. Come on and read.
Amen. And he weared up the court round about the tabernacle.
Come on.
And the altar, and set up the hanging of the court gate.
My Lord, set up the hanging of the court gate, the last little, weared up to, so you got cleaning, integrity, and you got detailed living. You'll never find real glory if somebody is compromising the standards of God.
All right.
Ain't no, you want to shout louder, please, louder than any other. If you compromise the stand, the detail, the standards of the doctrine, the details of the church.
Amen.
Here he said, they rode up the rear, and they walked in, and said, the last look, this wasn't a brazen altar. Justification, this wasn't a golden altar. That was already done. This was the last little bit. He said, now it's finished. Let's read.
So Moses finished the work.
Come on.
Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation.
Come on.
And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle.
Any congregation that you see, they're going to have integrity, holiness throughout. And you're going to see detailed preaching, detailed living, clear, solid word of God. And it said the glory filled. But what also, along with the clean and the detail, go back to chapter 36. Read verse number 1.
And every wise hearted man.
Come on.
And who the Lord put wisdom and understanding.
Come on.
To know how to work all manner of work for the service of the sanctuary.
Uh-huh.
According to all that the Lord had commanded.
Read.
And Moses called Bezaleel and Aholiab and every wise hearted man.
Come on.
And whose heart the Lord had put wisdom, even everyone whose heart stirred him up to come unto the work to do.
So Moses called them out and said, come, help us build the tabernacle, help us in any other call and consecration reasons.
And they received of Moses all the offerings which the children of Israel had brought for the work of the service.
So they received the word and they brought all the offerings, all the sacrifices. Come on and read.
To make it withal.
Uh-huh.
And they brought yet unto him free offerings every morning.
Meaning that it was free will. Nobody forced him to do it. And he wanted to do it. Come on and read.
And all the wise men
come on.
That brought all the work of the sanctuary
uh-huh.
came every man from his work which they made.
My. Come on.
And they spake unto Moses, saying, the people bring much more than enough for the service of the work.
Amen.
Keep reading, my Lord. Glory.
Which the Lord commanded to make.
Come on.
And Moses gave commandment, and they caused it to be proclaimed throughout.
So Moses had to bring another commandment. Read.
Saying, let neither man nor woman make any more work for the offering of the sanctuary.
Come on.
So the people were restrained from bringing.
My Lord. So you see, the calf was present in this congregation.
Amen.
In which the people brought too much, in which it was more than enough, to the point that he had to say, stop it. Don't bring no more. Don't hold on. They were so committed. They were so, whenever you see a congregation with glory, you're going to see a people, my God, that put their all into it. They're sacrificing, prayer meeting, whatever it takes, my God. Young people, whatever it takes, my God. We want more. What do you need? So-and-so sick? Let's sacrifice. Let's pray them through, my God, to the point where the pastor is going to say, saint, don't overwhelm them. I know they're sick, but don't everybody go over there and pray. Don't everybody, my God, what? My God, hold on. You'll see the sacrifice.
My God.
And the sacrifice came before the glory. Over in, and we're not going to go here. Over in King Solomon, it said, King David, with the great glory and the reason why he was so blessed, they said that he came and he wanted to get this threshing floor from Ornan. And Ornan said, the king wants it here. I'm going to give it to you. Here's the, I'm going to give you the sacrifice. I'm going to give you the floor. I'm going to give you. And David said, he understood the calf. He said, no, no. I must pay the full price. I must pay the full price. It ain't about my voice. I got to pray before I get up there. It ain't about me just knowing some scripture. I must get before God and lock up with him beforehand. I don't want it unless I pay the full price. That brother paid the full price and God stayed the family. God blessed the people, so on and so forth. Amen. Over as we close, to show you the example, and we're done. 2 Chronicles 7:7, Solomon gave the best example of a congregation of sacrifice. The face of the Lamb. The face of the Lamb. Come on.
Moreover, Solomon hallowed the middle of the court.
So Solomon hallowed, that means he's consecrated the middle of the court. What in the world is this? Watch this.
That was before the house of the Lord.
Come on.
For there he offered burnt offerings and the fat of the peace offerings, because the brazen altar which Solomon had made.
He's not supposed to be doing that. The sacrifices was to be on the brazen altar. Solomon, what are you doing? Why did he do this? Read.
Was not able to.
Because the brazen altar.
Because the brazen altar which Solomon had made was not able to receive the burnt offering and the meat offering and the fat.
This brother had to consecrate at another service. This brother, because the sacrifice. Why was it that way? Go back to verse 5.
And King Solomon offered a sacrifice of 22,000 oxen and 100.
Two or 2,000?
22,000?
Come on and read.
And 120,000 sheep. So the king and all the people dedicated.
Hold on, read that again. How many?
120,000 sheep.
Saints, are you seeing this? It said nobody was blessed in a raid like Solomon. David, they're still talking about him way over in the New Testament. David, sacrifice. Anybody where there is real glory, you're going to see sacrifice. Willing to give their all to the body collectively, willing to support the move going forward. And I'm not going to go there, but apostasy comes in when you have those that are endeavoring to minister that are not sacrificing sufficiently. Over, and we can't go there, we ran out of time. But over in 2 Chronicles, chapter 30, it said that they could not minister because the priests had not sanctified themselves sufficiently. The moment you begin to have people up and doing things, and they're not really lining up and sacrificing like they should, there's a power. Now, what had happened was, is that they wanted to worship and celebrate the Passover. The Passover was the most glorious festivity in all of Israel. It represented, my God, the Passover. It represented their most historical occasion. So they wanted to celebrate the Passover. But God said, no, the priests ain't sanctified themselves sufficiently. No. The glory you all want? No.
My God.
No. Just getting up and they just grab a song and they say, sing yes. You're not praying before.
No.
You do what you want? You want the glory of the church of God? He's got somebody getting up because they know how to talk. They just grab a scripture and they say, they're not really laboring before God.
No, God.
They're not seeing what is the church going through. What do the saints need? What's it? No. No. They're not involved in the prayer service.
All right.
They're not in the, no, that's just, it is what it is. Mm. No, they're leading homes. Yeah. But they're not sacrificing. They're not having family devotion. Yeah. They're not bringing the children to Sunday. The glory y'all want? Y'all want the Passover glory. Why? No. Husband, wife, and home pray together. Yeah, what y'all want? You're not sacred. The face of the calf is missing. The anointing you want when you get up, you want to feel inspiration.
Amen.
You want to impart something. You can have a measure of it, but what you're after is going to take more of the face of the Lamb. The face of the Lamb is essential in order for us personally to be in tune with God. I seen an individual get saved, and there was some stuff they didn't cut off. They were leaving here, putting on their phone with their boyfriend. Been saved for a month, 2 months. Knowing that their boyfriend was ungodly, this, that, and the other, God told him, all he wants to do is involve himself with you. You're saved now. Amen. You cannot be unequally yoked. You're a saved woman now. You can't be involved in him. And someone clicked. Still texting, poking. What a face of the Lamb, man. Mm-hmm. Trust God. Give your life to God, brother. Give your life off. Cut all that off. You end up blocking your blessing. Cut that foolishness off, man. Cut that foolishness off. Still got stuff. They didn't get rid of this outfit. It's still in their closet. Sacrifice that, man. Let that go. God got something great for us. God got power for us, saints. God got glory for us. God got anointing for us. You can have an anointing. You can have deliverance. You can have power. But it always must have the face of the Lamb. Shall we stand?
Praise God for the truth of God, man.